First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
No doubt. Back once again with Dr. El-Bey. And we have a special guest for you tonight, Dr. Baba Phil Valentine L. And he's going to be speaking on the reign of the Neanderthal or the Neo-Neanderthal and the systematic annihilation of global humanity. Brother Phil, are you there?
Yes, I am, brother.
Greetings. How are you doing today?
I'm well. Thank you very much. And yourself?
Doing well. Glad that you are here and appreciate you for coming on.
My pleasure. You're welcome.
All right. What you got for us tonight?
Well, I have a little something that I've been working on pretty much based on what people have been actually giving me in the form of reports, justifying and validating some lectures that I had done years ago.
Right.
Related to the fact that the European of today is actually someone that I refer to as the Neo-Neanderthal, or who he's now calling himself, Humenthal. He's now actually adopting a euphemism around what we've been speaking about, and of course what it is that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad had spoken to us about, and the myth of Yaqub and the whole nine yards. And a lot of people, a lot of my students, who had viewed that videotape of the tape I did, where I showed that the sons of Esau and Japheth, those who are, you know, breaking down the codes of the Bible and so forth, coming up and speaking to the fact that I believe it's Genesis 25 and 25 when they speak about Rebecca having a child, and the first one who came out who was supposed to serve the younger. The older one serving the younger. The first one who came out was red, and his whole body was a hairy garment. In other words, he was covered with hair. So you figure that the redhead, essentially the redheaded entity, straight-haired entity, was exactly what it is that the scientists today are now classifying as the Neanderthal. So there are stories that are in the Bible that are justifying the fact that there may have been two creations. He is now, of course, justifying his humanity by putting all kinds of information out that has nothing to do with science. It has more to do with his pseudoscience that he is trying to fit into a puzzle that he has created based upon his sciences of anthropology and archaeology. So there are certain things that he is now saying that doesn't seem to make sense. For instance, in dealing with his marked inferiority complex of what it is that he's now found out about his genetics. Of course, studying the human genetics now has made it even more difficult for him to justify his existence. Of course, you know that the rape and the digging up of Africa, the desecration of tombs of our ancestors, and the breaking up of tribes and the destruction, the complete and wanton destruction of historical information as well as historical monuments and so forth, would mean nothing to him at this point because of what I have come to understand as the empathetic disconnect that the Neanderthal has for the true man being, because basically there are no genetics linking him to the true man. And so therefore we now have to deal with his abandonment issues, or at least his amnesiac issues of not knowing where he originates from. So as I'm saying in the new upcoming Hidden Colors, that the deeper the white anthropologist digs the earth and in Africa and all places where indigenous peoples live, the blacker the planet becomes. Everywhere he goes for any evidence of his existence, he keeps digging up black artifacts, black remnants of the fact that this was a black planet. Now he has taken his own archaeology or archaeological tenets and archaeological practice, began digging into the DNA, into the tombs, or into the parts of the human body that have within it buried certain scientific evidence as to who the true humanity was on this planet. And now that he has dug and found no connection to who he said were the original peoples in Africa, his entire science said that all life began in Africa. That being the case, how come there are no pieces of evidence in his own genetics to connect him to the sub-Saharan peoples that he knows to be the original peoples of Africa? So what I have been saying for the longest is that the disconnect and the ability for him to keep his wanton savagery and disconnect from the feelings and from the sufferings of African people is because he no longer, or pretty much does not, or ever have ever had any connections to the true man being, which is the true human being on this planet.
I mean, that definitely correlates to the information I've been studying too. I mean, if your heritage is non-African, then you are part Neanderthal, according to the new studies in the July issue of the Molecular Biology and Evolution. Discovery News has also reported on this Neanderthal and so-called human interbreeding for some time. But like you said, if it was humans in which they interbreed with Neanderthal, then they would have African a connection. But since they don't, then they are lying about the research in which that they've been to, in which that they are even coming out saying. And they are still trying to say that the Neanderthal man came from out of Africa about 30,000 years ago.
Yeah. He is trying to connect himself to what it is that everywhere on the planet shows to be human. He does not have that connection. Everything he has been based on his conquest and absorption of cultures and complete destruction and estrangement and separation of those peoples from the culture that he has now absorbed. It's interesting, a incredible author named Franz Fallon stated in one of his works about the Europeans' mindset is that when he had conquered, destroyed African civilizations, he began to turn them psychologically into what became known by Freud or with Freud as the other. The other is this beast that the European believes lives on the borders of his civilization, and that the borders of civilization essentially is representative of everything that is not him. So when he conquered, he not only took the land, but he took everything that was on the land as well as was within the people themselves. So he stole culture, he stole science, he stole everything, absorbed it, became it, and actually in his own psychosis believed that it belonged to him. Because based on the fact that he was superior and actually conquered these people, then he had a right to their mindset, and that they no longer had a right to their own psychology and mindset, that it now belongs to me. It's the Elvis syndrome. So that particular mentality now is now playing itself into the way the European is now legitimizing his excursion into recolonizing Africa. He is stating now that according to the genetics that we have that they have now discovered, if you have any traces of Neanderthal, it would not make you an African anymore.
Mm.
So now what he's now saying is that if the Africans who, quote-unquote, migrated out of Africa interbred with the Neanderthals and then reintegrated back into Africa, it means that they're not Africans. Therefore, they can lay claim to the territories based upon that type of indigenous parasitic hitching a ride genetically into Africa, the same way that they're claiming to be so-called Native Americans over here, and they're pale white.
Sure.
This is the kind of interface, but the thing I want to get our brothers and sisters to realize is show them that everywhere that you are looking at this point, when you're looking at the so-called alpha European, the one that is now shown to be the higher order of human being, the ones that they show you in their anthropology, when they show you the monkey and then the gradation and the evolution of humanity from the monkey, you don't ever see Africans standing right behind the white man. It goes straight from monkey to white man. Therefore, he does not include us in whatever he calls his evolutionary strain. But you can see that the Neanderthal, which now he has embraced because of his genome project, is now discovering that he is a Neanderthal. At least 4 to 10% of the Neanderthal strain is in what they call the new Homo sapien, or the new human being, him calling himself human now that he's interfaced with that genetic, with those genetics. If you can look at the so-called higher order, or the European, the Caucasoid, who is now so-called ruling the planet, he is pale almost to the point of being sheet white and with red hair. Therefore, all indications of the Neanderthal, which I was speaking years ago about, that the Neanderthal still is, or the Neo-Neanderthal is the ruler, so-called, of the planet now, or has now conquered based on that rulership, you can see that the ruling hierarchy are all redheads. You could look at the prince, what's his name? Not Andrew, but his brother. You can look at all the movies you see out today, the TV. There's always these redhead white women that they're promoting, redhead in all your commercials. Open your eyes. Take a deeper look at who it is that they're promoting to you as the alpha human being. And it is most assuredly and invariably in the main red-headed and pale. So now you're watching the Neo-Neanderthal essentially trying to invest into your psyche who it is that you need to emulate and who it is that now rules the planet.
Mm. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. When you're looking at the Neanderthal, I know that I've read articles about them being cannibalistic. And if you're talking about 4 to 10% of that is within their genetic strand, even today, you know, I mean, where does that stand at as far as the current information that we've been talking about? I know that it's been all over the place about the blood sacrificing and so forth and so on.
Yeah, anything that has to do with red is essentially what they are dealing with now, blood sacrifices being just one of them, being the symbology. Looking at anything red, you look at Rothschild, Red Shield. Rothschild pretty much runs the banking system for the entire planet now. Estimated a worth at $800 trillion.
Mm.
If you look at the new movies that are coming out, all the superheroes now, if you're looking at children's movies coming out of children's cartoons coming out of Japan with the hentais and all the rest of these cartoons, there are all these red-headed, white and pale Neanderthal throwbacks to what they call the superior human. The same is also evident if you're looking at the new superheroes when you look at the word Thor. The word Thor spelled backwards is Roth, and Roth in German is red. So these, everywhere you go, you will see that the Neanderthal is actually showing you who he is. And now that he is coming out showing you scientifically that this is who he is telling you that even if, instead of it being the other way around, dig the psychology, dig the reverse psychology. We know that the black African, what they call the black African, or the Nubanoid African, the one that the indigenous autochthonous human being was coal black, almost to the point of disappearing at night with a hue. That's where the hue came in, that radiated hue, that iridescence that the skin gave off in either blue or green tones. This particular human now was the original and is the dominant genetic strand. But then now they're going to reverse the psychology and tell you that if you have any bit of genetics, it's not that you are an African with some Neanderthal genetics based on interbreeding, but that you are a Neanderthal with African genetics. So what they're doing essentially is flipping the script and making you believe that the recessive can now claim dominance and say that you are a Neanderthal by essentially the interbreeding of the Neanderthal with the indigenous Africans. So the ones that are in the northern part that they say have been interbred with the Neanderthals, all this being explained about him saying that, you know, those who go back to Africa are still Neanderthals, still not explaining where the Neanderthal originated. If the human is actually originated in Africa, where do you come from? And everywhere he digs on the planet, he still cannot find evidence for his existence.
Well, that might go back to what Honorable Elijah Muhammad spoke about, is that they was made in a laboratory,
mm-hmm.
and by, as we would say, 24 scientists, and that. That is where, that genetic manipulation actually took place at. And so, yeah. I mean, that would account for the fact why they are so interested in, genetics. You don't see, said the average, black, Moorish person, interested in those types of things.
Yeah.
It's always, the promotion of it, as we see within the media, via cartoon, via internet, so forth and so on, so that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, it does. In fact, I would have to say, and I've said in all of my lectures as well, that Yaku had to be an insane man.
Right.
He was insane. Everybody says, well, he did create a so-called humanoid. The word, we have to get to understand, that's what I call him. He says he's human, but I more deal with the word humanoid.
Right.
The word oid is mostly connected to who he really is. The word oid is a suffix, and that suffix means resembling something, or
right.
having the appearance of, or one that resembles something specified, or something that is specialized quality of something. So if it is a humanoid, it means that if he is saying that the original human, which I call the true man being, the original true man being is actually the original starting point for the humanoid strain, no matter what it took, what variations on the theme it took, if that was the original, and he finds nothing of that in himself, then yes, as they speak about the fact that he may have been grafted, then you have to look at this as the story also, his psychological projection of this particular traumatic event of his creation or his second creation. This may be why Mary Shelley and all the rest of these people put together these monster movies called Frankenstein.
Right.
And it's Frankenstein. Frankenstein is this entity that was grafted from all these different parts to create this humanoid entity. But then what did this humanoid entity do? It came back and destroyed the village. So essentially, that's essentially what we're facing here today. If Yaku was the scientist that actually perpetrated this kind of scientific, unethical scientific practice, then we are actually paying for that in the form of this entity coming back that has no empathetic connection to black people at all. Even with his connection to touching us and giving us a little bit of handouts through his different forms of so-called charity organizations, it has nothing to do with empathetic connection. And now you see in all of our religions, the Christian religion is a ripoff of the African spirituality. There's been no spirituality that originated when the Neanderthal existed. No spirituality came out of the North at all. Nothing came out of Europe. Nothing spiritual ever originated or came out of Europe, no matter what they're telling you about the Norse this or the Norse that and all of these different types of that all migrated north, took on another language, and that was how they actually got their information. And if you look at Norse mythology, it has a connection to African mythology, but it has their own traumatic base in it. Now, I'm saying that based upon all the movies they've put out. One movie our brothers and sisters have to pay attention to is the new movie called Prometheus that came out. When you understand the story of Prometheus, you'll understand who Prometheus was and what Prometheus did in order to raise this glob of clay called humanity. And you have to look at him psychologically projecting his own inner racial memory into his stories. That's where the myths come from. It's a racial memory and an experience that comes out in the form of elaborate tales. Well, Prometheus, seeing this glob of walking flesh that had nothing to do, barbaric, eating one another, killing one another, or walking around mindless, looking like they're suffering because of their ignorance, Prometheus steals the fires of the gods and gives it to this entity. He now becomes punished for that. Come to find out that the gods now, after Prometheus, chains him to a rock and goes after his creations. In the story, he takes his ship, goes up to look for the progenitors, and the progenitors try to destroy him. This is his story. It ain't got nothing to do with us. Not a thing to do with us.
No doubt about it. And, of course, like you said, it has semblance to, you know, information, you know, coming from out of ancient Egypt or Africa in particular, you know, with the story of Ra sending Sekhmet to destroy, you know, humanity. And we got her drunk, you know, as they would say. She forgot about destroying humanity altogether, you know, and she fell asleep. So, you know, Sekhmet would be symbolic to that fire in that regard, too. So, you know, it's the tales in which they have taken, and they have, you know, as you basically, as you stated, has perverted in order to attempt to give themselves a history.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. They don't have one. They don't have one, and they are seeking one by taking ours. And they're juxtaposing themselves onto a human history, taking our philosophy, turning it into a religion, and organizing themselves around religious principles rather than philosophically scientific principles that our ancestors had left for the planet. And now those people, and I just want to put a caveat here, those of you who are listening to me speak and saying that because we're targeting this particular information, that we are dealing from some kind of reverse racism or some kind of other nonsense that Europeans have created, words that they create to deflect reasoning and logic away from certain discussions, it has nothing to do with racism. All we are doing is looking at the facts as discovered by the European himself. And instead of looking at it through the European scheme of things, we are not being censored by the Europeans' own way of looking at the information, and we are not interpreting it in accordance with the European data. He may give you all this elaborate information that he's accrued based on his myopic science, but there is another science that goes deeper, the science of the mind behind the person scrutinizing the information. I like to know more about the mind. That's why I don't deal with history. I deal with mystery, my story. Mystery, I'm a historian. As a historian, I don't deal with historians. His story is one that deals with justifying his existence. I have to know what it is that in my story, as a mysterian, as a metaphysician, as one who deals with the mystery behind the history, that's where I want to go. Who, not just don't just write to me and tell me what, because that's what history is. History is to tell you what someone did and what the consequences of their acts were. I want to know the who behind the what, the why behind the what, the when behind the what. And when you begin to know behind, what's going on behind what it is that's being given to you as a screen called history, then the mystery, which is the mysterians, we are the ones who have to now decipher in accordance with what we saw him do, not what he likes to tell us he did, but what his effects on us have done. No one is allowed from that other side to tell the story, because then they're saying, well, no, the proof is not in this, because I've had 500 years to look at the information, so you should be listening to me. You were just an African at that particular time, running around with a bone in your nose, eating one another and savage, and had no history, as they told Dr. Clark. And we came along and lifted you out of your primitive savagery, and we gave you everything now, so you must trust us. No, that time is over. This is the end of time at this point, his time, and it is for us to do an entire new review of what he has laid out before us as data, according to what he says is the history. Hotep.
Mm-hmm. You back?
Yeah, I'm just made a comment.
I we didn't hear that last part. Something happened and it went out.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can hear you now. I'm not sure whether or not I didn't know what part came in or what part left out, but I was speaking about the difference between his story and the historian, who is what he is, and me as my historian, because I'm a historian, which is begins with MY, my history. So as I deal with the mysteries behind the history, I am a historian. And as that, I teach metaphysics. I teach the people what is the causal principle behind the effectual. And once you understand the causal principles, what I was speaking about, not just the what of history, which is what they want you to study, what happened. No, I want to know who was behind it, when it was behind the what, why behind the what, and what was the psychology behind the who behind the what.
I agree. We have to know those, have to ask those questions in order to find those answers. You know, as you said, within our story, you know, my story, our heritage, you know, it has to definitely come from other sources outside of what he has presented to us through the educational system, you know, which we know, you know, is a crock of lies. The information that I know I was taught in school, you know, from kindergarten up to the eighth grade, was that George Washington was the first president. Then when I get to the eighth grade, my teacher, Mr. Harrison says, oh, no, he wasn't the first president. John Hanson was. And so you should have seen the students in class. Everyone of our mouths just dropped. Our jaws dropped because he's like, hold up. Then why y'all been telling us this nonsense for, you know, all these years?
You know? Yeah.
So,
mm-hmm. Most people don't know that actually Hanson was actually the president. He was actually administrated or someone who was elected from the Continental Congress at that time. And Washington, in accordance with breaking free from England, they were going to make him king of America. But that's when they stepped in and began to put together the Continental Congress and put together all the laws.
I think Hansen, actually the pictures they show of Hansen was way past the time when they actually had a daguerreotype or even a photograph to make of anybody. So essentially we have to kind of adjust the mystery around that history as well.
Right.
Anyway, the main thing that I was wanting to actually focus on is that there is a definite estrangement of human qualities that disconnects the what I call the parasitic elite, the ones who have brought the burden of pain and suffering and the madness that we now experience and share in the entire humanity, no matter what the haploid group you belong to at this point. What we are looking at is a blood strain that, you know, they're very, 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 very strict about who they intermarry with.
Right.
And very necessary for them to marry white and very, very pale with no black in them. But they've been mixing up. You've been finding even Obama has got his Neanderthal connections all around. You can hardly find any black. They only show you his connections to white people. They never show you his African connections, because that, of course, goes directly through Malcolm X. So that part you never see, because they know that if you were to give him the Obama Senior, that would be ridiculous, because the Odom tribe would be definitely not where you could find his particular genetic strain. But definitely we are looking at the coming out and the bearing of all secrets around who it is that's actually running the madness that we call life on planet Earth today. That this neo-Neanderthal has been essentially estranged from the human population, and his abandonment issue, his estrangement issues, is what you find in the hostility between black and white at this point psychologically. And it is very, very difficult for us and even for white people to even accept the fact that they have this ingrained fear of a black planet, and that ingrained fear of a black planet, that they are the only ones who carry the psychosis and the fear of genetic annihilation. Black people don't carry that fear, that ingrained fear of genetic annihilation. Only white people do, which is why they are so anal about who it is that marries them if they're dark or so forth, especially the ones that are in the upper crust. And again, for those of you believing that this is about racism, it is not. There is a true fact that you are not aware of. There is something that you are not aware of when it comes to the psychology of the ruling class white elite. The psychology of the ruling class white elite, their history, their exclusive history, and how they see themselves as estranged from the rest of humanity, especially black humanity. And now that the genetics prove that they are of a strain that does not have, they keep talking about how the Neanderthal intermixed with Africans who migrated out. Well, then where did they come from? Nobody is giving any origins to them. They tell us that the first original man came from an ape, and he was in Africa and migrated out of Africa and went up to northern Europe, stayed there during the Ice Age and came back. Well, then why is it that in the Neanderthal genetics we do not find any of the sub-Saharan genetics?
Right.
Until they answer that question logically and satisfactorily, then we are still essentially in a no zone when it comes to actually identifying where this European, this Neanderthal really came from.
Right. Well, I know also from my research is that, you know, if you get the book Forbidden Archaeology by Michael Creedmore, he states in there that humanity existed on this planet 2.8 billion years ago, with the proof coming from various magazines over the years from blasting in which that took place in South Africa and different other places, in which that they found exquisite artwork on metallic objects, in which that metallic items is actually unknown. Mm-hmm. You know, so
yeah.
I mean, as far as them
laser technologies that engraved information of as yet identifiable language that was found on the Smaragdine tablets.
Mm-hmm.
They have things that they dated back 2 million years, and it had a specific type of alloy that they cannot find anywhere on the planet. The other thing is that in my book, the book that I'm working on called Cosmic Codex, Book of the Earth, I speak of the fact that there was never a time that man was not. So trying to date back man to 1 million or 2 million, these are little drops in the bucket of reality and creation and existence. There was never a time that man was not family. Man has always existed from the time the Creator folded over onto itself in order for it to know itself. Man was and is and always will be. There is no ending to man and all the variations that man may take in this journey to consciousness of self. This is how the Creator works. It works through self-examination. And in that self-examination, if the Creator has no beginning and has no end and is in constant examination of itself through its existence, then man has always existed.
Mm. No doubt about it. As the Moorish Holy Quran says, time never was when man was not.
That's right. There was never a time that man was not. And this is the time that we have to come to this understanding and understanding of ourselves. We are constantly looking for some kind of origin because the European puts it that way. We have our myths and our stories of all of our beginnings as well. But this is just to make sure that there is some kind of starting point for. We need to find a starting point. Everybody needs to find that they came from somewhere, which is why it's driving the European crazy. He can't decipher the myths. He doesn't know what to do with the information he has. He can only now take the puzzle and then try to reorganize it and force it to fit. It's not fitting anyway, because every time he thought he has it to fit, something else comes up to show him he was wrong. So there is no true European science.
Well, that would account for the fact that, like David Icke in his book, The Biggest Secret, he stated that, you know, whites come from Mars. So... Now they
No. Family don't believe it. That's a lie. You know why? Because the Ethiopians already claimed that.
Exactly.
So he cannot say he came from Mars. And even when he went to sit before the master of Credo Mutwa, Credo Mutwa said that the Zulus say they came from Mars.
That's right.
And look at all the so-called reptilian creatures and fake features that he has. You see, they all look like African with scarification, tribal scarifications on their faces.
Right.
So the game that he's playing is, again, who am I? This madness is a child with a 357 Magnum, a four-year-old with a 357 Magnum, and he's holding everybody else at bay, shooting and killing everybody with it, crying and screaming, having temper tantrums and not knowing who am I. Somebody tell me who am I. But when we tell him who he is, he doesn't want to accept it. It's like you're looking at Psycho. Anybody know that movie called Psycho?
No, yeah.
Right. So Norman Bates, I say that in my book, he has this that you can actually compare the Europeans' behavior around the world to Norman Bates. He seems normal on the surface, but he has this mother issue. He takes on his mother, he goes around and starts killing everybody, and he wipes out the earth, kills off everybody, and stuffs them, puts them into museums so he can look at them.
Yeah,
look
that's
at
a serious cycle.
He's sick. And this kind of mentality where he can kill off anything that he feels that his mother complex got him threatening. And you remember, it's the same mother complex like Psycho. It's the same mother complex. They don't like us for our freedoms. Ain't that what George Bush said?
Yeah.
So we must destroy them before they destroy us, since they don't like us. So you can't agree with him. If you don't agree with him, he want to kill you. He gets emotionally involved. That's why I say that this is not a patriarchy. Don't believe the hype. We are in a feminist matriarchy, a actual pathological matriarchy that is what is actually ruling the planet today.
Mm. Whew, I'm telling you. That's, we're looking at psychopaths, so... I mean, that's the mentality. I remember reading Bobby E. Wright's book, you know, Psychopathic Personality, you know, and that right there cleared it up for me, you know.
I mean, Norman Bates.
Right.
Norman Bates.
Exactly. I know that cleared it up for me. He said there's only three things that you're going to do with a psychopath. He said, you know, put it in jail or prison, lobotomize it or kill it, murder it. So So,
there may be, I guess, some people believe that he can be redeemed, and that is all redemption is self-redemption. But when somebody does not believe that they're sick, and they believe that the sickness that they're spreading is actually somehow healthy for the rest of the world, how do you know what the insanity is when you've made everybody else insane?
Mm.
So what you're looking at is people of African descent here in the Western Hemisphere that has been conquered by the mindset of the Neo-Neanderthal. We are not acting like him, so we are acting in the same psychotic manner he is. So when you're looking at someone who is acting as psychotic as you, or you believe that you're acting normally when you're psychotic, if you can be in a world with the kind of madness that this man perpetrates on the rest of the world, there are more people of color dying every day, millions of people of color dying every day and every week and every month, but you can't see those same numbers of people dying in Europe or any place where there are white or Caucasoid peoples.
Mm.
So if you can live in the kind of madness and sickness that the planet is now and adapt to it and just become numb to it, then what are you? You know, what have you become? You have essentially become infected by the same psychotic germ or virus called Western civilization.
Right. And that would account for, as we would say, black devils.
Yeah. Look at our people today. Look at our young people today. You know, the sickness has definitely caught on. It has become infectious in our community. And you got young men that you went from Malcolm and the nation and brothers standing tall and taking their place as the leaders of communities to some idiot walking with his pants under his ass. You got to really look at the condition of our humanity, our brothers and sisters, and what has happened to us today.
Yeah, we definitely have to. You know, it goes back to another book that I studied. It was called They Stole It, But We Must Return It. So, I mean, the things in which that, you know, like right now, what you're speaking on and many others are putting out there, you know, it's just time for the people to start listening and putting the pieces of this puzzle together, like you were saying. You know, instead of dealing with his story, start dealing with my story, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mystery.
Right, mm-hmm. Mystery. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The history is, you know, like this again, the historian instead of the historian is what we all have to become. What is your story? Because within your genetics, especially within the mitochondria of our sister, which is why they would like to abscond with our sisters and brothers, because we have the genetic code that contains the memory of this planet, and they want that memory carried on in the genetics, in the DNA, in the melanin. So they will find themselves definitely dipping into the pool, into this gene pool, because it is necessary for their survival. This is the fountain of youth, the gene pool that they must bathe in order to resuscitate their genetics, because their genetics will die out. It is. That's the way it is, and it will happen. They have to interbreed with someone who has the original genetics of the planet in order for them to sustain and maintain who they are.
And I know that they've been having problems trying to actually, you know, when it comes to the so-called human genome project, I know they had problems, you know, decoding our DNA.
Because they were dealing with only six. They only found six strands to their DNA, when the people from the sub-Saharan had nine.
Mm.
So now when they found out that the sub-Saharan Africans had nine strands of DNA that they could identify, which essentially is, again, going back, a lot of people is talking, I hear a lot of my students coming back from what the European so-called New Age movement, which again is that Neo-Neanderthal trying to create a history for himself by pimping all of our religious philosophical sciences and trying to make a so-called New Age out of it to give himself validation from here on after the 2012 time. We're watching the same kind of madness hit and the same kind of things that he has been giving to us in little drops and drips through these New Age movements. They are validating themselves by taking over information that didn't belong to them so that they can validate some kind. You look on the, I know I'm jumping back and forth because we don't have much time, but if you go up now onto things like Crystal Links and all the rest of these, this guy Melchizedek and John Bello Melchizedek and the rest of these people, and telling them where they came from, the planet Lyra and all these lizard people and everybody else, they have this incredible story that they keep telling everyone about these people that come from outer space, that essentially where they came from. So they speak about these blonde, blue-eyed, 6 foot to 10 foot tall people that came to visit Eisenhower and right. told him that this is where they came from, the planet, or the, you know, the planet, but the constellation Lyra.
Right, the Astarians, as they call themselves.
Yeah, yeah. So this is their... This is their origin. They came from another planet, which is why they're probably out there shooting them rockets at different places to try to find themselves. But what it is that they're doing is not going to work anymore. Like I said, they can't validate themselves because genetically they can't validate themselves. So all of what you see on the planet, this is why it's so easy for them in the form of these Muslims or Islamic members of the Neanderthal branch that call themselves the Muslim Brotherhood. This is why they can so easily just destroy African histories. The Buddha, they could blow the Buddha up because they're not connected to those Afrikoid peoples.
Right.
So they're going to create a whole new history by destroying and putting up water and making it impassable or inaccessible so that if you could see the projection here, if there's no accessibility to their past, then we will have no accessibility to yours. You will have no accessibility to yours. So that any story that the dominant culture puts up as history for the rest of the planet, that's what we're going to take, and that's what we're going to accept, and that's what your children will only know.
Right. Now, you spoke about also 2012, and of course, we're in this time span right now. Based on everything in which that you just talked about and also on the New Age movement and their twist on the 2012, you know, what you think is coming down the pike?
Well, everybody is looking for 2012. I'm looking at 2012 as at least, I'd say, let me see, about 15 years off the mark, because everything that's supposed to have been happening for us and to us related to 2012 actually began in 1997. Mm. And what we have been going through is a radical change in the consciousness of the planet, as well as the sun, as well as our interfacing with other planets that are coming, that we are actually flying into their neighborhood. And that we are not again, I'm going to say this again, as has been verified by some Brazilian scientists, that we are not actually circling the planet, the sun, because why else would they then shoot a rocket to try to find out what was on the other side of the sun? It doesn't make any sense. It seems to me that we're not really paying attention to what he says and how unscientific and illogical it is for a small little pebble to be going around, being held in place and not fall into the sun by the so-called, by us circling this gigantic orb of fire and light. So what is actually happening is the sun itself and the solar system is traveling at about 42,000 miles an hour, and that we are actually being dragged behind the sun, and that the sun has us in a wake, its wake, and that wake takes the design of a torus, and we are in a very elegant movement and interplay and dance with the other planets around the back end of the sun as it travels around a central course galaxy system. And in that interplay, we are now coming into connection with other neighborhoods that our ancestors from 61 to 144 to 288,000 years ago, we are now interfacing with those planets that they say, oh, we found a new planet. No, they're not new. We're just going around this incredible carousel of light. And this carousel of light is taking us now at this position in time into all these places that our ancestors once saw and wrote down and stuck into the tombs. They put it all on the wall, etched it in stone so that it would not be disturbed by time, would not be destroyed by time.
So they would tell us that this is now coming up to an alignment, a galactical alignment in which that would take place every 26,000 years. Would that be accounted for the fact that of us seeing, you know, this alignment is occurring and that we are, you know, seeing these new planets and systems and so forth and so on?
Well, you see, there it is now that we are now coming to see the lies of the European.
Right.
And how he games us. Here we go talking about 20,000 years ago that we were still Neanderthals and we were still knuckle-dragging apes from the caves, and we were essentially just these primitive entities that seemed to have come together to have it, but yet still he could talk about an alignment of 26,000 years. So it would have to be that you have existed for 26,000 years to know that there was a 26,000 years of alignment. So how is it that science is telling us that there is a 26,000-year alignment? You have to have at least two 26,000-year alignment to know that it was existed. First, you verify it with the first one that you may have recognized, but you have to validate it on the second go-round. Check?
Check.
Right. So then if that's the case, then it must be that if there was a 26,000-year cycle, that means there had to have been a 52,000 years ago, and that would hit right in line with the origins of the pyramid, the actual pyramid of Giza, because the capstone of Giza is aligned to the Polaris star, and it is off by 0.1 degree, and that directly connects to 52,000 years ago when the Polaris star was aligned directly at that point.
There we go.
So how is it that we are now these Neanderthals that 60,000 years ago we were just in caves, 50,000 years ago he came down and he interbred? It's all nonsense. We cannot validate or even accept any of his science. We have to take it apart. As soon as he puts it out there, we trash it with what it is that we know, and we make sure that African peoples, especially our children, are not buying into this nonsense.
Right. Well, let me see. I'm thinking about the fact of a lot of stuff, you know, because there's a lot of New Age stuff in which that's done been thrown up into the mix, you know, when we come into the terms of metaphysics. I know I had a guest on not too long ago who spoke about the fact that African people, you know, shouldn't even be dealing with metaphysics, you know, and I started laughing. But then in the same breath started stating about the fact that is, you know, that we should be dealing with spirituality, you know.
But what is spirituality? Metaphysics is nothing more than the logical sequencing of spirituality into a format that can be understood.
Right.
Metaphysics is nothing more than an investigative branch of spirituality. So to estrange metaphysics is to take away the language of spirituality. That's all metaphysics is.
Right.
It is putting a language to spirituality so that we may much more easily interface with each other to relate how we feel and what it is that we are personally experiencing. To say we don't study metaphysics, we don't study metaphysics here. We study chemetaphysics here.
Right.
We study the higher physics, or what we call the zeptepi, or the first time, or the first order.
Right.
We call it zeptophysics, and that's what we are dealing with here. So metaphysics itself, just using that, I know if he doesn't want to use that as the Greek terminology, meta meaning beyond, physics meaning that which is tangible, I can understand that, no. But we are not just studying metaphysics because we have been forced to have this language, to use the language of the Neanderthal in order to describe our world, but we could still go back and twist our language around into our own. As we have always done.
No doubt about it. All right, we at the top of the hour. We get ready to play a song, and then we're going to come back with some question and answers. And You ready for some question and answer?
Yes, sir.
All right.
If they're logical and if we're not getting into any kind of debate or hostility, no problem.
Right. Well, don't worry. We'll mute them if they try to do that. All right. So we got a question for you. And the question is, they want me in the chat room, man, 50 mentioned, want to know about speaking on the ingestion of the pineal gland by the secret societies and what is it that they are attempting to gain by doing so.
I didn't hear that question. It was just a little bit kind of low. What was that?
Right. The question is that secret societies ingest the pineal gland. What are they attempting to gain by doing so?
Inject the pineal gland?
Ingest. Eat.
Okay, you're breaking up pretty badly now. I'm not getting a lot of what you're saying.
Ingest.
Okay, I'm sorry, beloved. Spell that out.
They're talking about ingesting.
Oh, ingesting pineal
right.
gland.
Right.
Oh, yeah, well, that's just like, you know, it's ridiculous. The pineal gland essentially has certain types of materials in it, you know, that would act only in concert with other parts of your nervous system. So that's just like, you know, taking the testicles of a bull and eating it and thinking that you're going to have sexual strength. It's all in the mind. And I just see most of the people, most of these people who are dealing with that kind of mentality are dealing from a mentality that essentially, because the pineal gland is the end result of a process, that somehow the end result process, once consumed, you can gain that. No, the pineal gland is the end point. It's like eating a light bulb. It's eating a light bulb and hoping to get the energy from the actual generator that actually put the light on. It's ridiculous. And don't it doesn't have any significance. If it does, it's only for them.
Okay. We got another caller. Area code 314. You're on the line. 314.
Islam, boss.
Islam.
This is Brother Veteran L calling out of St. Louis, Missouri Republic. Yes,
brother.
Sir. I'm fine, brother. How you doing?
Doing well.
Yes, sir. How you doing there, Brother Valentine L?
I'm well, sir. I'm well. How are you?
Praise Allah. Yes, sir. I was listening to you earlier when you were talking about how they say they derive from the Neanderthal man. From the Neanderthal man through the ape, I mean from the ape through the Neanderthal man, and you don't see any of the Asiatic brothers or sisters behind them. So well, what that says to me that they don't have any real place in the human family. That's what you're saying?
Yeah, I'm saying essentially that what is being classified according to their pseudoscience as human is now
right.
being reclassified as Homo sapiens. Homo sapien, to me, being a homo, that he says actually hold the 4 to 10% of the Neanderthal DNA, a hybrid of the Neanderthal and the so-called humans that he calls modern-day humans today. I'm still looking for the origins of that original Neanderthal type that he says is his progenitor. That's the one I'm saying. So if he's saying that everyone who has Neanderthal now is a Neanderthal rather than an African, then it's obvious that he is now claiming that he is not human.
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, they don't have no real origin in the human family.
No, they don't. The true
they
human, that's why I'm saying there's a humanity now, which we call the H-U-E-M-A-N-I-T-Y, but I'm calling it now based upon him introducing this new integer, this new equation. I'm calling us true humanity now because he's calling himself Humanthals, or something like that. That's his new name for himself.
So, like you said, another statement you made about them saying they came from Mars, the European David Icke,
mm-hmm.
claims they're coming from Mars. and you cleared that up. And you said, "Oh, that's a lie. That, the Ethiopians are claiming that."
Yes, they have, so, and they have documents to that effect. And in fact, what the planet that you the city called Cairo in Kemet is actually the name for Mars.
Exactly. Exactly. I know that they feel like even their women kind of age earlier in life. More than we do. I'll put it that way. I think that has a lot to do with it also.
I'm sorry, Blood. I didn't mean to cut you off. But what they're doing, remember, there is a political agenda afoot, and we have to look at it in long range. When they are now claiming that anyone with a Neanderthal strain cannot be called human anymore, what they are saying is that they have a license to come into Africa based upon them and claim all the things, everything they've stolen, justifiably theirs.
Right.
So when you are speaking about that, when you're speaking about any kind of claims that they are making genetically, just like we are making autochthonous claims to the land, because we can find the flora and fauna of all of the genetics of the plant life on this planet in our DNA, which makes us autochthonous to this planet. If we can do that, then they now have to find at the root of your own
right.
So-called humanity to give justification for where they are residing. They have to give the planet back, but now they have to find ways to legally say that we belong here too.
Right. And I was listening earlier when you said that they had stolen a lot of our spirituality from the comedic and more sciences and call it their own, you know. And what's so wild about it that they're Europeanized comedic and sciences, a lot of our people become slaves to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm looking at that in the Buddhist religions as well. They are now putting qualifying adjectives before the word Buddhism now. Buddha being an African man and all of the vestiges of African culture showing on his person. You can see that his very makeup, the curly hair, the elongated ears, everything is Africoid. But yet still they have all these different versions of Buddhism because they have so-called Asians that are actually taking over it and calling it Nichiren Buddhism or different other types of Buddhism in order to lay claim. So remember, there is in the Phoenician vernacular that once you've named it, you own it. So that's why the European is now across the entire world, wherever you see Europeans, they are actually trying to classify and barcode every form of life on this planet, because once you have named it, you
mm-hmm.
own it.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Yes, they you can see they're trying to barcode it. Even I saw on a commercial where this European was watching television. He had a barcode on the back of his neck.
Yeah, exactly. And you can see the again. Look at your commercials. I have to do this for my brothers and my students who come to my university, who are at my university, have their homework. And half of it sometimes is just to look at television and then to make a qualifiable distinction between when they are trying to promote their white racism to you, their manifest destiny to you, and when it is that they're accepting you to become part of that particular scenario. And everywhere you go, in all of the new television programs and all of the new movies, you will see red-headed entities. Remember, the Neanderthal is red-headed. So everywhere you see the cartoons, like this new one that came out, Brave, everybody there is a Neanderthal in that cartoon. And everyone in all of these other little cartoons you see are the red-headed, little blondes and red-headed ones. They're all promoting the Neanderthal strain as a superior strain. So anybody, a monkey, can imitate anything. So when you say that these people who are supposed to be so smart, because remember, in their early sciences, they said that the Neanderthal was just this grunting creature who ran down elephants and buffalo and lived in the caves. Now they have imbued him with all of this incredible science, but still we can't see where the science that the Neanderthal had back then. Nobody can actually deal with that. So but what they're saying now is the interfaceable Neanderthal, the one that interfaced with the Africans who migrated out of Africa, that's the one that had all of the higher sciences. But he's not African anymore because he's now Neanderthal. You have to look at the circular logic of this Caucasoid. He is definitely desperate to find an origin for himself. He finds everybody else's origins except his own. So he must adopt some kind of mythological science
mm-hmm.
in order to make sure he is validated as part of the human family.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking about an experience I had in the library, and I was standing in the aisle where they had all the history of Kemet, of the great pharaohs and Akhenaten and everybody. And this Caucasian lady and her grandson was in the library. And her grandson ran toward all these Kemetic artifacts and books. And he was looking at Akhenaten. And he said, "Grandma, come on over here. Come on over here." Then she told him, "No, honey, come on. Get away from there. That's not us. That's not us." Then when she went over there to grab him, then she looked at me. She was so embarrassed, she took the little boy out.
Mm-hmm.
Went back outside.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's so interesting. It's so interesting you said that, because you have to understand and understand, too, that Akhenaten actually was one of the people responsible for introducing another part of the fall of humanity, of ancient Kemet. It was Akhenaten that opened up the borders of Kemet to all of the other, you know, the areas of Syria and all of the other Hyksos and the other members of the Neanderthals to come into Kemet to join this new religion called Aten. Remember, at the time, the political substructure of Kemet was a priesthood based in the Amen priesthood, which, of course, had gone corrupt. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about the fact that the different houses, the different temples of Amen, of Sekhmet, and so forth, these were political institutions. Because remember, the so-called Kemetic civilization was actually a theocracy. So these particular temples represented houses of political intrigue, if you want to use that. So really, what he said was, no, there's no more democracy of one temple talking over political issues for Kemet over the other. There's only going to be one.
Mm-hmm.
So what he introduced was an autocracy, which was rebelled against by, of course, Horenheb, as well as Ramesses, because he had to drive him out of Kemet. And because of Akhenaten saying no more worshiping of the many different godheads, he was part of the Hyksos, or supposed to be part of the Hyksos family. And his only personal connection to the ancient Semites was his mother. So what we are dealing with at this particular time is him interfacing Kemet with all of these Hyksos, not really the Hyksos, but I would say the Neanderthal. We're not even going to call Hyksos anymore. He was bringing in, the borders of Kemet were falling. Kemet itself had gone to pot. There was crime, there was madness. And it was Horenheb who said, "We've got to get rid of this guy," because he moved his whole caravan out there, created a place called Alamana, and everybody was singing Kumbaya while Kemet was going to hell on the handbasket. So when they drove him out of Kemet proper, the people that were actually on the isle there, on the Nile, at a place called Malawi, the priests of Malawi, those were the Levites. Those became the Levites that wrote the Bible and all the rest of it, who hated Kemet. Because they drove Akhenaten, who was the Moses of that time, out of it through the Sinai into the bogs, which they talked about according to the Red Sea. So understand that that what we are now getting is ancient Kemet and all the, from the 13th dynasty, I guess the 13th or 14th dynasty, that's when the foreign invaders had come in. That's
right.
The time when Kemet began to be interfused with all of it, and its eventual fall to Alexander and the rest of them. But I'm just to make sure that they understand that Akhenaten himself, as he began, his father, he began to take information and began to bring all kinds of different people into Kemet and told them that they could rule Kemet. And Kemet was going to hell because he didn't really give a damn about the politics, the economics, nothing. And most people don't know that about Akhenaten.
Right. We have another question. Area code 336. Area code 336. You on the line.
Hey, what's going on, Brother Lane? Brother Fields?
Peace.
What's going on? Hey, I just have this one question, man. Like, I like to read about the human body and everything, about, you know, understanding melanin, how they always talking about this ascending with the alignment 2012. And they say that we are the same. But, you know, me reading all this stuff about them killing off black people, you know, drinking up their, you know, melanin and all of that, I'm just trying to find out, like, why they're going so hard saying that about we all the same, but then they turn around on the flip side, you know, taking the
nap. I understand, beloved. I understand exactly what you're saying. It's called insanity. It's called psychotic. It's called cognitive dissonance. It's called psychasthenic behavior. It's the same kind of behavior that a madman will legitimize in his own right through his own megalomania. He's quite sane. So you have to understand and understand that we're not dealing with the same entity. And he double talks. He needs to. Everything about him is a lie because he does not know the truth about himself.
Okay.
Everything he ascends to understand about himself spiritually, you can look back in time and find the title to that knowledge in Africa or somewhere in ancient Dravidia, because they found a text in ancient India which was written by the Imhotep of the Dravidians. His name was Mahmuni Mahayan, and this man, they found a script that he wrote 10,000 years ago. Where was the European then?
Wow. Okay. Yeah, I just been asking myself that question like every night. I've been staying up by like 2:30 after I get finished reading a book or something. I'll just be sitting there trying to figure out, like, it's just going back and forth, like it's just contradicting himself. Just.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you know, insane people contradict themselves and they live in paradoxes. I mean, I myself do not dispel paradox, because paradox is part of the yin and yang principles of existence. You deal in paradox if you're dealing in the metaphysical world. But the paradox he's dealing with has no legitimacy or central point in truth. His paradoxes are learned behaviorisms in reaction to his lies. So he keeps constantly revising his sciences to try to match them with his lies. And his sciences constantly are revised every 5 years, and he's telling you all about what he's discovered, but what he is actually doing is rediscovering his own lies and trying to find a way to now lie to you in a different way.
Okay, because I'd be up and, you know, I'd talk to my queen, I'd be like, it must be something major about to take place for them to, you know, keep going mm-hmm. around saying this and saying that.
It's already taking place, brother.
No, oh, okay.
The enlightenment is here. That's why you're even talking about this subject.
Okay. All right, I appreciate it.
All right, brother.
All right.
Peace. You got area code 678. Area code 678, you're on the line.
US dollar and next.
Peace.
$22 per MC,
but
from, I mean,
who's
that?
I don't know. We got area code 424. Area code 424. You on the line? Peace.
Hi. Hello. How are you?
Right. How you doing? Greetings.
Oh man. First of all, I would like to say, Phil Valentine opened my eyes and enlightened me to so many things. Ever since my awakening, I mean, I've been on his tail because, I mean, he's been showing me truth, and it's just been manifested in my everyday living, in my spirit. I mean, I'm just walking in the light, and I'm just so happy to be awoke. And to be honest, my awakening happened on June 6, 2012, this year, and it was the exact day of the Venus crossing the sun. And, I mean, do that signify anything? I can recall on that day, my dog, he was really fearful and scared. He was barking all day. He's a little puppy. He's about 5 months old, and he was just barking all day and hiding under the couch, and it was just strange behavior. So could he enlighten me on anything that's supposed to happen that day?
Well, it happened. It was showing you that there was an oversensitizing. The Venus energy has to do with kundalini energy. It has to do with balancing energy.
It's that love energy, the heart energy. It connection, depending on where it is in conjunction with Leo, it definitely has to do with normalizing or activating something in you. Once you make an affirmation to Venus at that time, it's supposed to last. Well, it happened, I think, where Mars was and where Venus was. That's supposed to last for the next 200 years. So whatever affirmations you made at that time, whatever you were thinking of at that time, whatever you were putting forward at that time in your Venus mindset, which is, again, love, harmony, and it is also addiction, because it showed you Venus being connected to Cupid's arrow. Cupid's arrow is not all cute and you're saying, oh, you're falling in love. It's also being sexually addicted.
Okay. Well, I'm a Sagittarius. That's just part of me. But thank you so much for blessing me with that, and have a wonderful day. Thank you so much,
you
Phil.
Yo, you're welcome. All right, we got another caller, area code 718. 718, area code, you on the line.
Hello?
Hey.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hey, hi, Phil Valentine's. Hi, Alim Bey. My question for today is, even though there's a huge movement within the conscious community, isn't it still a few chosen that is going to move away, so there's, in a sense, not going to be unity going on? You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, because I do.
It, within the conscious community, everybody has, like, their, like, own outlook, and I'm just trying to find my way to, like, fit in, or which way to go with this whole thing.
Well, that could be the trap of the conscious community. Most people are coming into the knowledge of self, and they believe that that means to estrange themselves from others and to find their own way and be damned with the rest. That's not how it is. It doesn't work that way. The self is one thing. We are participating in it as the many, but it is the one thing. The true self itself brings you back to harmony with all other selves that are awake. It doesn't mean that you are going to be completely, you know, going in other directions. You are all going in the same direction, that is, towards enlightenment. And everyone will act in accordance with that, and the world will reflect that in the social that is hovering or is surrounding our planet. We have a social consciousness that is around the planet right now that's being shaken up by the investment of enlightenment that is now being dominated as the thoughts are now surrounded with this kind of newfound knowledge of self. So everything that we're putting off from that point now is going to change the harmonics of this planet. And that's the dangerous part. This is why they're covering up the skies with all this chemtrails. This is why they're giving you these new advanced iPods and these new galaxies and so forth, these new phones, is to disrupt your electromagnetic field. This is why in 2015 you're going to have very thick chips all over. You're going to have it in your clothing, where if you buy something, you're going to be able to track you according to your card number, so that if they want to know where you are anywhere on this planet, if you got a pair of jeans that you're wearing with a very chip in it and you bought it with your card, they can track you. That's why I say to brothers and sisters, it's time for you to start making your own clothing and be damned with wholesaling it. Try to get it from your place where you can just send it out, mail order it to your peoples and so forth. You're going to have to find ways right now to get out of the system, because everything your boy Obama has done is to get you ensnared within the new kind of web of the parasitic elite, which is to make sure that everyone on the planet, including bugs, including animals, including everything that flies or swims, has a tracking device on it that they can control. Remember, since they don't know who they are, they want to always know who you are.
Thank you so much for this vital information. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And I will keep listening. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we got another question in the chat room. 50 Minutes, you want to know, what is the connection between chemtrails and solar flares?
Chemtrails?
And solar flares.
Oh, and solar flares. Well, flares is actually the consciousness of the sun. Most people say, well, this is the sun is going off and so forth. Well, that's consciousness. The flares are also a way of a child or the father sending out certain signals and information to the rest of its children in order for it to raise its consciousness. Because remember, the programming for our consciousness time zone is localized in our sun. The sun contains the programming for our ascension in consciousness. And as it beams out or it sacrifices its light for the redemption of man, does that sound familiar? As the sun sacrifices its life, the Son of God sacrifices its light for the redemption of man. We are essentially now getting that in the form of these bursts of output of energies that essentially shakes up the planet, changes it, purifies it, destroys what's not real on it, which is why consciousness is burning up. The false consciousness is burning up, and people who have been living in false consciousness are suffering, eating the wrong foods, going along with the same kind of nonsense. You either come to understand and understand that you are part of the enlightenment journey that the planet is experiencing, or the planet itself is going to discard you, and you'll essentially take yourself out of the equation. So the sun itself, and this is what I teach my students, the sun is a earth in formation. Just like this earth was once a sun. This is where you get the Adam and Eve, or the Atum and Eve myth, where Eve was created from the rib of Adam. Well, this is what the sun is doing. By giving up its light for the redemption of the present human, it is dying and actually being transformed. Look at the sun as a chrysalis, the way a caterpillar forms a chrysalis and then goes through a process and stage before it becomes a butterfly. The earth, with all its colors and all its beauty, is the butterfly of a former chrysalis or a former sun. And so as we're looking at the sun today, you also are there finding that there are life forms on the sun, life forms of entities who have taken on the journey towards manifestation in the flesh, just like we did. And they are now carrying their own programming for when they become an earth and they begin to manifest and incarnate on that planet that is created from that process.
Mm. All right. Hopefully that answered the question, because it definitely did it for me. We got area code 561. Area code 561, you're on the line.
Hello, how you doing, Dr. Adam and Dr. Phil? Yeah, this is Henry from West Palm, and I just wanted to thank you guys, and I had a question that sometimes I have, like, these reoccurring dreams, like I am, like, in this place, and I'm kind of lost, like in apartments or some, like, areas where I can't find my way. And I just wanted, like, an insight. I've been having these dreams like this since I was young. And I'm still now 41 years old. I'm still having these same dreams, like I can't find my way around.
Well, I can tell you that anytime you feel like you're lost, it's something that you didn't find while you were awake, essentially. And a lot of times, dreams are not actual dreams that one walks consciously through, but actually reoccurring unanswered questions in our waking states that take on the form of hieroglyphic expressions. Since we don't dream in words, we dream in pictures, and we dream in actions that we see or place ourselves in, then these are hieroglyphics that are giving us indications that we are searching for answers in our waking state that we have not yet arrived at.
Wow, that's pretty deep. You had some input about that, about the day?
Oh, no, that was perfect.
That was perfect, wasn't it? Thank you, Dr. Phil. I really appreciate it. We talked some time ago, and I just followed you on another blog talk when you were talking with a brother that was calling you Jehudi.
Yes, that is my temple name, Jehudi.
Yes. And you say that you came about through Brother Kanya.
Yes, Brother Kanya was the place that had the the Tree of Life in Manhattan at the time I was in, I began my search, yes.
Yeah, because I actually met him down in Atlanta like maybe 4 or 5 years ago. He lived with his sister.
Mm-hmm.
And we must have talked for about 4 or 5 hours, me and the queen and I, and he enlightened me big time, and it was a beautiful, beautiful awakening with him. And I just wanted to just put that out there. I really appreciate you guys, and you guys are doing a great job.
Thank you.
All right. Appreciate you, brother. Thank you for listening. All right, we got area code 313. Area code 313 on the line.
Hello?
Yes, please.
Yes, something just beeped. I have a question. Dr. Valentine, how are you?
I'm well, beloved, and you?
I am great. I have been not exhausted, but I can just be, like, going about my day, and the next thing you know, I will have to lay down for, like, 30 minutes, and then it's like I'm a new person. But I'm not the type of person who takes a nap. I just, you know what I'm saying, I can just go on. But lately, it's just like I have to lay down for like 30 minutes. And next thing you know, I pop up and I'm like a new person. Does that have to do with like what's going on energy-wise on our planet? Or, you know, the spirit keeps saying metamorphosis. I'm like, okay, what exactly is, you know, the end stage of this? I'm just trying to get some understanding on that.
Yeah, you're on point. The transcendence of the planet itself and the adjustment of people who are sensitive to the change, to what is called the quickening, they have to sleep. As a matter of fact, in a number of my lectures many years ago, I spoke about during the time of the transition that people will either lose appetites, gain appetites. Mostly they will feel sleepy, tired. They may get a lot of headaches that come out of nowhere that are uncommon to them. This is the adjustment, a lot of times, the adjustment period. You may find yourself sleeping on the bus. It doesn't take anything for you to be knocked out. Also, you may want to check the blood harmonics. Your blood harmonics may need to carefully step up. That's why I recommend people, you know, go to my site and deal with getting Juice Plus. Everyone who is in the transitioning period at this point, going into a higher level, a higher octave, higher harmonics, they need to get pure concentrated fruits and vegetables that have the 98 to 99% of their enzymic activities intact. And through experimentation, through investigation, and through research, I came up with that product, which is what I recommend to people. So if you do want to find out more about how you can get that kind of nutrients, you should call me at 1-800-847-1291. Again, 800-847-1291. And if you have a child 4 years of age and over, and you do purchase the Juice Plus, and especially all three of the spectrums, the fruit, the vegetable, and the berry blend, even though you just get the fruit and the vegetables, I will sponsor your four-year-old child and over, even a child who is in college and the child is enrolled full-time. Either a four-year-old child and over or a college child who is enrolled full-time, I will sponsor that child with free Juice Plus for up to three years. So what we want to do is to get our children to eat more fruits and vegetables, get more nutrients into them, proper, concentrated, full-bred nutrients for this transitional period, and get the blood harmonics of our people up to snuff with the harmonics of the planet. That's why a lot of people are having problems. Young people are getting heart attacks. Young people are finding cancers coming out all of a sudden, all of their bodies. They're being readjusted for the change, for the quickening. So this is why it is necessary that young people, as well as older people, begin to see the value of pure and good nutrition and the support system that Juice Plus gives to them.
Yes, and it's funny, Dr. Valentine, that you brought that up, because this is Tiffany from Detroit. I spoke with you probably 2 months ago, and I am definitely on it. Just some things have been coming up, and I've been doing cleanses and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I was just wondering, I'm like, because I'm a very anxious person, I'm like, okay, why hasn't you know, the funds come through, what's happening, but I know to get calm, and when it's time to come through, it will. But I am just elated. You know, I have not forgotten. So it's on and popping. And thank you for answering my question. And I will be in touch. Peace and blessing to you both. Love you. Bye bye.
And blessings. All right, we got area code 609. Area code 609, you're on the line.
This is Brother Vincent. Peace. This is Brother Vincent from New Jersey.
Greetings.
Yo, Chuck.
Greetings, Dr. Phil and Dr. Eileen. It's always a pleasure hearing you guys expound on greater wisdom. My question is talking about the Neanderthal. Even when the Bible, I'm a student of the Bible, and I'm finding out in my studies now that everything written in so-called scriptures is symbolism, symbolic. It's not literal. So as we understand Adam or Adam, is that our understanding of what the creation of thinking man was, as opposed to the Neanderthal before him?
Well, it's interesting that you should say that, because what does the word Adam mean?
Adam, what we're made of.
Yeah, what does the word Adam mean? What does it break down to?
From my understanding, I even from the Quran, it's related to thinking man, or man with the ability to reason.
Yeah, but it breaks down technically.
Wrong, I don't have a full understanding, but that's from what I understand.
Well, technically it breaks down to meaning red clay. And there you go again.
Okay.
So, essentially,
okay,
he's giving you another version of his mystery, his myth story, and he's trying to validate it as some form of science. Of course, within all of what, remember, it was the Levites, or the Lawarian, the Malawian priests, who took all of the writings and put that together to be formed the so-called Holy Babel. And it is in that book that you may find little traces of what could be the history of this planet in relating to his experiences when he came out of the caves of the Ice Age. So, yes, we may take a lot of the information that is written down, but until we have it validated again by those who were there telling us, and they're there already, because actually everything written on the walls is written within our DNA. And all we have to do is just concentrate and just focus and meditate on the so-called hieroglyphs or the Medunecha, and we will reawaken the Medunecha within the DNA and the mitochondria, because that's where it all originated anyway. So it's necessary for him to whitewash or to essentially interbreed with Africans, so that interbreeding really is what stifles and suppresses and buries the knowledge, or discards or displaces the DNA. It is his introduction into the world that has displaced people. So what people don't see is that connected to that is when he has introduced his bloodline into the African woman and into the African man, he has displaced their DNA, which is why there's so much junk laying around. What else is there in the societies? If you see where he's destroyed, that's what they're looking through, the bric-a-brac. Well, here they are now looking into the bric-a-brac of their own DNA, what they destroyed within themselves.
Yes, that's very true. I come to find out now that I'm opening my studies up to more metaphysical principles and esoteric understanding, that even the Garden of Eden is recognized as the systems within our body. It's not a geographical location.
Well, yeah, Gan Hadad is actually what it's called. It wasn't the Garden of Eden. That's they said Garden of Eden, but it was actually, in the Hebrew, it's Gan Hadad.
Okay.
So the Garden of Eden essentially is what creation is. The Garden of Eden is the folding over of chaos into order. So there are little pockets or harmonic envelopes of holographic envelopes that contain a seed programming for the school that the Creator has created for itself as it passed from one vibrational frequency in its own DNA line to another. So what we are right now, we're in a seed packet, and in Kabbalah it's called the Adam, actually now graduating to become the Adam Kadmon.
Oh, wow. Could you expound on some greater understanding of there's a verse in the scripture that talks about, I believe, Ezekiel chapter 31:15 talks about Pharaoh being in the Garden of Eden. And, you know, of course, if you're used to church understanding, you know Pharaoh is only been recognized as just a king, a generic king of Egypt, or, you know, Kenneth. Could you give some metaphysical understanding to that?
Well, as far as Pharaoh, we know him as the Nesut Biti. The Pharaoh, I think the name itself is foreign. It may have a more Western mentality. The word Pharaoh might have originated from the Kemites that were living here in the West. But the word Pharaoh did not exist in the East as a name for a king. The actual name for the king was the Nesut Biti. And that Nesut Biti, essentially, the one that we're speaking about as far as the Pharaoh in the garden, all of the writings of what became known as Psalms was actually the writings of Akhenaten.
Wow. Wow.
So when Akhenaten had, remember, at that time the Nesut Biti were actually initiated into the higher temple knowledge. So if you were to read a lot of Psalms, you would see a lot of ancient Kemetic sciences based on raising Kundalini and dealing in the spiritual space in his writings, which became so-called the Psalms of David. It's nonsense. But it was Akhenaten that wrote at least two-thirds of it. And if you look at the Psalms, you will see that at the ending, the priests from Malawi, which essentially took the Kemetic information and actually created the Kabbalah and Kabbalistic writings and took the astrological templates of the sky at particular positions around the planet and made the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet, you would see that there also at the ending of Psalms that the 22 letters of the alphabet are broken down in the back end of that.
Yes.
So the connection of the priests of Malawi to Akhenaten can be found there.
Wow. Wow. Thank you very much. Definitely get some enlightenment.
Mm-hmm. All right, we have a question coming from out the room dealing with the blood types. For example, it is stated that O blood type is around 200 to 300,000 years old, and its blood type is A blood type, which is around 20,000 years old or so, and B blood type is around 13,000, and AB blood type is around 2,000. Do the blood types fit into the scenario if we use that as a path of validation with the creation of the Neanderthal man, in which that they state is around 20 to 30,000 years old?
That is exactly. The Rh negative is also Neanderthal.
Right.
And what they call reptilian blood. The other thing is that the O blood is not O based upon O in a letter of the alphabet. O is the full circle. The O blood represents the 360 degree, 22-strand DNA. Because she's talking about the European.
Get out of the refrigerator. Get out of the refrigerator. That was that. Get out of the refrigerator. I'm not being.
Okay. Hello?
We here.
Okay. What they keep talking to us, the Europeans like Drummond Vellum, Melchizedek, and Anna Hayes and all the rest of them keep talking about 12-strand DNA rebinding together. Well, 12 strands may be what they have, but African peoples, the ancient, original, archetypal spirit man, actually had 22 strands, and each one of these strands are related to the 22 letters of the alphabet. And if you were to put the letters of the Hebrew alphabet together in a line in a row, you would have that as a string being representative of the DNA of the raised man, which they call the Adam Kadmon. The 22-strand DNA is representative of what they call the O blood. Remember, the O blood has a crystal harmonic that picks up information on all levels, the dodecahedron. It contains all the different crystalline shapes. The archetypal blood has and can change its crystalline shapes. Now, here's the secret now. In the bloodstream of the evolving or higher evolved humanity or humanity, all the different forms that light takes in order for it to crystallize through the sacred geometries can be changed in the blood, because remember, the blood is nothing more than liquid crystal. And every time the human entity begins to transcend to higher levels of consciousness, the ability to switch the blood into these different harmonic shapes to triangulate the human mind to different consciousness levels is the changing of the blood harmonic through a template of different ones, tetrahedron, dodecahedron, octahedrons, and so forth. So the changing of the blood crystal in the body and throughout the body structure of the higher order of man is man's ability to use his mind to shift the blood crystal into these different sacred geometric shapes to pick up different forms of information from what I call the spectroglyphs, which are the lights broadcasted from all around the universe and all around creation towards this central point.
All right. Thank you for that. We also have this last question coming up, in which that is coming from area code 336. Area code 336, you on the line.
Hey, Brother Phil, Brother Aline, this is 336 from early on. I was just trying to find out a little bit more information on about the blood types. Because me and my queen, we were talking about that earlier, and I was trying to figure out where can I go to find out more, because I'm O, and she's blood type A.
Well, the main thing is that I don't have all my information and my research in yet. I'm doing a book called Mel Analysis, The Metaphysics of Dark Matter Consciousness, and in it I'm going to speak about blood types. I may touch upon it also in my book Cosmic Codex, which again are all works in progress. But as far as information related to that, the Europeans have books out right now talking about the different diets that most people with different blood types need to have in order to stay healthy. But okay. The basic essentially is that, I'm not sure what the names of the books are, I forgot the names of it. There was a European that had some very interesting information about it, and I forgot his name, old school. It was just on the tip of my tongue. I'm having a senior moment here.
Yeah, I found one book that said how to eat by your blood type, and then he had blood
type. Yeah, that's one way. But there's a what is his name? He's very well known in the occult circles. One of the better ones that
Otima.
I'm sorry?
Hilton Otima?
No, not Otima.
No.
Otima mentions him though. That information I'll probably put out at a later date, you know, since it's something that most people are wondering. But in my school, I teach about the blood harmonics and, what I call the blood song, BLOODSONG, metaphysics of the blood song and the harmonics that we give off based upon where our consciousness and our intention is placed.
Okay. All right, I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm, no problem.
All right. Well, Baba Phil, this is coming to the end of the show. We appreciate you coming on. You have any closing remarks, anything that you want to leave us with?
Well, personally, I'm hoping that I will be in Philadelphia. I'm kind of putting that out there a little bit before. I'm actually jumping, leaping before I'm looking at this point. But I've been given an invitation to come to Philadelphia sometime in August, the end of August. So everybody, please be on the lookout for that. And I will be putting information out to that effect for Philly. And again, for those of you who are interested in our university, you can call 800-847-1291, or you can go up to www.uksnow, in other words, uksnow.org, uksnow.org. And for those of you who wish to really enhance your blood and to put it back on an even keel with your fruits and vegetables, I suggest very highly that you look into the Juice Plus. You can also go up online and check it at Rethink, that's R-E-T-H-I-N-K, Juice Plus, J-U-I-C-E-P-L-U-S.com, RethinkJuicePlus.com. And again, if you have any questions and you would like to have your child be on our child health study program, where I will sponsor that child who is 4 years of age and over with free Juice Plus for up to 3 years, make sure you call that number, 800-847-1291. And again, brother, thank you so much for your invitation to speak to the family. I enjoyed myself.
I appreciate you for coming on, because I know that the audience enjoyed it, and I'm sure we're going to get your feedback. You know, we'd definitely love to have you on again. And that's www.juiceplus.com, right?
No. It's www.rethink.
Rethink.
Because if you do juiceplus.com, you may go to somebody else's website.
You want
to go to my
sure.
website, which is Rethink, like Rethink, R-E-T-H-I-N-K, juiceplus.com.
Got you. You want to make sure, because that's what was posted up in the chat room, so we want to make sure that it's the right one. All right.
Well, if they're not sure about it, beloved, just tell them to give me a call at that number.
All right. Definitely will. All right. We appreciate you, and we definitely want to try to have you back on again. And you have a good night.
Same here, beloved. Good night to the family. Hotep.
Hotep. Area code 347, you're on the line.
Oh, good night, Dr. Bay. How you doing? This is Deborah. I was great show. All the best to your guest, Mr. Dr. Valentine. He was excellent. I want to ask you about Moringa, if you'd be interested in hearing a show about Moringa.
Yeah, that's fine.
Do you know when?
That's up to you. When would be a good time? I know I have a show this week. Next week, y'all, come on back. We're going to have Black Dot and Brother Mass come on. And they're going to take up those 2 hours, and they're going to give you a lot of information, all right? But whenever you want to, in August, we can do that.
All right, thank you so much. I appreciate it. All the best.
All right, you too. Peace.
Bye-bye.
Area code 732. Area code 732, you're on the line.
Peace, brother. How you doing?
Peace.
Peace. My name's Vinos, but what I'm calling to ask you about, I'm recently getting nationality and everything. Can you briefly break down, because I'm not sure, I mean, I on all the different law words, the difference between resident, citizen, domicile, and things like that?
Oh, well, I mean, when it comes to nationality, you're talking about proclaiming your status, you know, as compared to being relegated into second-class citizenship, in which that the Constitution have you labeled within Article 1, Section 2 as 3/5 of a person.
Mm.
You know, that means two things are missing. And, of course, you know, Masonically, those two things would be your sight and your hearing. Because if I showed you, you wouldn't believe it, and if I told you, you wouldn't believe it. So in that regard, those are the two things in which that is missed from your sight, based on the 5 so-called senses. So you want to be in alignment with Article 6 of the Constitution, which is the Constitution, the supreme law of the land, its laws, and the treaties, you know. So there's more than just one Constitution. You know, you have four constitutions. You have the Articles of Association, the Articles of Confederation, the Declaration of Independence, and the Constitution for the United States of America. You know, so those are actually the four constitutions in which that any affidavit in which that you write up, it would state your indigenous free inhabitant as being an original or aboriginal being, you know, here in this Western Hemisphere, you know, having those roots, you know, that's what would be stated within the affidavit, you know, as well as also that's not a 14th Amendment citizen, because the 14th Amendment was never fully ratified. And that it was ratified, that means that you're not a U.S. citizen. And according to Dred Scott case, 1856, 1857, state that you would never be a citizen, nor are you a citizen. So these things has still stood the test of time, and all lawyers are taught this in school about the Dred Scott case. You know, so you use that to your advantage. You would state that you're not a 14th Amendment citizen because you're not a U.S. citizen. You know, which is 40-mile radius of what is now known as Washington, D.C. You're not a federalized citizen. You are an American, if that's what you would want to say, for lack of a better terminology, you know, or if you take it back to the original terminology, Amaruka. Okay, which the word America originates from. You know, so this is what information you will have within your affidavits. You know, you would do a denial of corporate status in which that it would state that you are not an artificial person or a corporate entity.
Right.
You know, with the name spelled in all caps, a straw man, but that you are a living, breathing, spiritual, or a sentient being.
Right, that makes sense. That answers my questions. You know, my brother Messiah, he's the one who told me to call in and listen to you. That's who I've been building with on things of the nature. So it definitely answers my question. Only other thing is, where else other than YouTube, is there a certain place I could look for all the, I guess, lectures you do and things you speak on?
You can actually hit me up at 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588.
All right. Where's 252-257-3588? Right. So I'll definitely do that. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, brother.
Peace.
Peace. Brother Els?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Peace.
What you thought about that?
Beautiful, brother. Outstanding.
All right.
Yes, sir. I see why you achieved the rank of Crown Prince, brother. Yes, sir. I saw that. I finished reading your book, which I most humbly and commemorate you. I mean, honor you again on the splendid work you did on your book, The First World Order.
Appreciate that.
I just finished reading it, and I have related that a lot of the subjects we talked tonight to that book.
Right.
Because you had a lot of, of where we're going as people on this planet and how the sun is operating, dealing with us entering the Aquarian age.
Right.
And our bodies have to be adjusted to that. Because I noticed this is the first summer I know. I never known a summer like this.
Right.
In all of my almost 60 years I've been on this planet, I never experienced a summer like this. Mm. And I was relating to what story you were talking about. You and a brother was walking down on Highway 54, I believe.
Right, 53. Mm-hmm.
53, okay, and it was so hot. But you were walking into the light.
Right.
You were like in a lucid dream-like state.
Right.
And you had walking all a bunch of corpses and bodies, nothing but Europeans.
Right. It was all around us. Right. And that vision or lucid dream took place in 98, not realizing that the Empress, Vidyasi Gestorna El-Bey of the Washtor, Empress of the Washtor, stated she had the same dream 4 years earlier, as well as also two other people who knew her, you know, or told her that they had the exact same dream too. So, you know, this, you know, is now as Baba Phil was talking about, or Baba Jehudi was talking about, he just said that, you know, it started in 1997, you know,
right.
What really was talking about the season of the 2012. So that will correlate to the fact of what was going on during that time between 94 and 98. It was already giving us clues on what was going to happen, you know, and this goes to the fact of everything that he talked about tonight.
Exactly.
You know, mm-hmm. The transformation in which that they are attempting to hold back based on the solar flare activity or the conscious energy of the sun transmutating us into Homos Christos and then destroying them in the process. You know, so mm-hmm. This is the reason for the chemtrails to attempt to cool down the planet or to, you know, keep these solar flares out. You know, at high levels, dangerous levels, you know, cold orange, cold red,
mm-hmm.
you know, so these are the things that is going on, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, like I said, I was listening to when you were talking. Like I told you last night, I was always like to contact Moors around the country and everything. And you were saying that, that's what grand sheiks do, you know. What did you mean by that? I mean,
about what part?
Yeah, I was talking about I was checking phone numbers to see who I can contact around the country, and I ran into Elihu
right.
in Pleasant Bay.
Right, Elihu Pleasant Bay, right. Mm-hmm.
And I was saying, I said, boy, I was really surprised, because yesterday I ran into Elihu in Pleasant Bay. I talked to you, and I talked to finally contacted Brother Rudra.
Right.
And I said, this must be something in the beginning, something that's getting ready to happen, along with this transformation.
Right.
Of the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you mentioned, you said, yeah, that's what grand sheiks do. You know,
right.
And
basically, I was talking about reaching out to each other.
Yes, uh-huh.
Right, you know, without the egos, just reaching out and trying to unify and build.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, the same week, I found out that I had the title of professor, you know.
Right.
So, so everything is like, everything's like it's falling in place, and Rudra and I and Brother Yada Bay, we all going to meet Friday.
Okay.
We're going to discuss what all we need to do to start us up a meeting.
Bless
you. Try to get up to start us up a temple if we can.
Mm-hmm.
He was so delighted that you told me to tell him that you would send him a charter.
Right.
Go to the temple, you know. So all he was saying is let's get this thing started, you know. And I'm also honored to speak with Dr. Phil Valentine tonight.
Right.
I've always seen him on DVDs and everything, read about him in books. So I actually got a chance to speak to him.
That's right. That's
so,
right.
Yeah,
that's right. Well, we appreciate everybody coming on tonight and listening and asking questions because y'all made the show. You know, those questions, you know. As Baba Phil said, you know, the intelligent questions, you know, I didn't have to get rude with anyone and knock them offline. So that's a good thing, you know, when we come to these types of shows, because it's sometimes can be very controversial, you know.
Right, right, right. That's understandable.
Right. First World Order Radio.
Finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
All right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Burr. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Burr. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Burr. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.